Subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon to never miss an update.
My IMC interview experience was very funny. I actually thought that I might need to show them some creativity because we hear a lot tell us a good quality and somebody says creativity and they say show it to me. So I thought that okay, let's try and show them. So I had made something on my iPad which could be considered digital art, and I tried to ask the person outside to let me take that into it. He said no, and they didn't let me in, but they said that okay, they had somehow the impression that I'm a digital artist. And so suddenly they asked me a question, ki, which is the most interesting bit of news you've read recently, and I had read so much that I had a brain freeze. And then they said ki, I said coronavirus, and they said okay, Mr. Digital Artist, you draw out the coronavirus for us, what do you think it looks like? And I didn't think they were serious because I'm not a digital artist, but because of that attempt to take the creativity into the interview, they got that idea. Luckily, I had a good moment in there. I drew the double helix structure of the DNA or RNA. Later, I found it was RNA that the coronavirus has. And luckily, that played out well. And then they went in from there. They went into maths on the middle of that intersection of the RNA of the double helix structure. They drew a plot, and the professor, he said that how will you find the area of this curve? And luckily, I'd drawn a parabola. So being an engineer, I was very, very familiar with that. And luckily, I worked my way out of that little spot. And after that, the interview was pretty smooth. They asked me about my experience at Infosys, experience at college. They asked me about football because I had written in my form that Arsenal Football Club was a big influence for me. And we had a good chat on that. And that was mainly my IMC interview experience. In the end, they even asked me to name the top three digital artists, at which point I had to say that I'm not one, and so I can't name them, and I had to tell them the real reason I'd made that. I made it for my girlfriend. So then this was a fun moment because one of the panelists then said it was 13th of February. So he was like, let this fellow go. He has Valentine's Day to prepare for. And it ended on a very, very light note. Other interviews, XLRI was a great, great experience, both PM and HRM. In HR, they said, you don't know anything about HR, but you're here. And I said that I'm here because I respect the institution. And this is one of the best colleges in the country. And then they talked about Infosys and HR policies and stuff. And in BM, again, I had a good chat with one of the panelists, Father Ozzy. We had a great, great chat. And in fact, I mailed him about it later. I just got the reply this morning from him. And it was general about management, leadership, about what sort of leadership we need, about how business is panning out these days, you know, capitalism, the values in economics, and why and how to improve. So that was great. MDI, I had a very, very interesting string of experiences, actually. One of my panelists, this lady, she was common across three of my interviews. The first interview was in 2018 in Calcutta, and in 2019 in Hyderabad, and again in 2020 in the same room, in the same hotel. When I met her, after 10 minutes of the conversation, it slowed down a little, and I told her that you're the panelist for the third time for me, and the other two times you rejected me. And she was like, why did I do that? And I said, maybe because my scores were low, I didn't do too well earlier. And then 2 minutes later, she was telling me about how this time I'd get in for sure. I don't know if she meant MDI or she meant somewhere good, but that was very, very fun. And I in fact told them that the first time I had met them, they had given me less than 5 minutes. Before me, the people in Hyderabad this year, they got about 10, 12 minutes. They gave me the respect of nearly 25 minutes. So my interview experiences this year have been that being honest about who I am and what I believe in, and trying to connect to the panelists, people, really, really help. Even at IMC, at MDI, IFT, and XLRI as well. And FMS, of course, thanks to some very, very crooked luck, didn't have any interviews at all, and I converted it on the basis of the score alone. So I'll just start with the written ability test. What I feel and what I've understood given my experience of giving those is that structure is the most important part of it. And if you structure your information well, if you put it into paragraphs which are connected logically and they flow into one another, and if it's relevant, of course, to the topic that is given, then that's the best one that you can write. It doesn't need to have, very Shashi Tharoor-ish language for that matter, or even it doesn't need to be very long. I've seen many of my peers score very well in VATs, we know from RTIs. And they have not written very long or very hi-fi English. What you need is coherent, logically connected, and relevant submissions to whatever they're asking of you. And to do that, mostly the VAT topics are on relevant social issues of the time, news, economies, the society around us widely. If you're even a little bit well-read about the issues that we are facing, most likely you will be able to ace the things that are given to you. For example, some of the VAT topics that I can remember are the debacle that WeWork went through in the startup space, the fact that we are looking at a self-driven car future and what it means for India. These are the sorts of things that were asked of us in these VATs. And the way to go through them is just follow logical structure, break it down into points, connect them, then write them down. Don't rush into the paper to write down everything, and that'll help. Other than VATs, filling forms, really, I've always had a bit of a contrarian opinion on this. What I felt is that you should be honest about it. Lots of people try to produce hobbies because they don't have any hobbies which sound, impressive to them. And my hobby, for example, is basically following football. And I'm a huge Arsenal fan. In all my interviews, somehow or the other, things have gotten into that. And I feel if you're talking about things about which you're really, really passionate, that thing will come through. So in Excel, HRM, in IIM Calcutta, in IFT, things went into that. Things went into Arsenal. Why do you follow Arsenal? Why do you love Arsene Wenger? What did you learn from him as a role model, etc.? These are things I can answer because I'm being honest. Lots of people, when filling forms, don't find the courage to be honest. And I find that to be honest is the greatest policy. So your thing could even be about movies. I've heard this season of interviews where people have said their hobby is movies, and they've been questioned on screenplays, screenwriters, dialogues, movies, directors, everything. So there are lots of different kinds of panelists out there, and if you happen to get one who will be knowing about your hobby or about your interests, great. If not, at least you can be honest even if there isn't a lot of interest from the other side. So filling the forms with things which depict somebody you are not will not work, because these are people who have taken probably hundreds of interviews across 10, 15 years. Some of them, even if they're alumni, they've been dealing with people in business situations where you have to find out what is true and what is not. They'll catch hold of your lies and it won't end well. So it's best to be honest about it and try to push up the things that you really value, that you are interested in. I got asked some politically charged questions. So in my one of my interviews, I was asked about the CAA NRC thing just after the riots in Delhi. And I said that perhaps the Prime Minister could have been a little more clear or transparent with the message, and maybe people were looking out for that. And the next question from the panel was, are you afraid of CAA NRC? And I said, no, I'm not. And they said that, why is that? I said, because I have my papers. So for example, that's completely honest, but that's not controversial. That's not contrarian. You're not taking them on head on, but you still said something which they may not expect. So I thought maybe they expected me to say that this is all nonsense, people are worried about nothing. And they were questioning me in that direction to imply that this was nothing. But when I told them that I'm not scared because my dad and his dad had papers, and there are people, poor people, who don't have them, they were like, okay, this is a fair point, this might end it. So it ended there. And there were other parts as well, when somebody asked me to name three good things that the current government has done with the economy and three bad things. I took a lot of time naming three good things because I was trying to get really three very, very good things and recent things. So they were like, why don't you know three good things, you know three bad things very well. And I told them that I'm trying to come up with better points, and it's always good to know both sides of the argument and then use your own mind to sift through them. So I feel unless you're being very, very harsh on one particular side, it's fine. I mean, you can express your opinions. Your opinion should not be so extreme that you are taken to be someone who values emotion over logic, because basically in these interviews they're trying to see, even if you're a good decision maker and you'll be a good manager or not in the future, if you're relying more on what someone has said or on some logic which is not your own and you can't articulate that logic, you can just play the blame game or call people names, then that's going to be a bit problematic. Stay away from that. Say what you want, but don't be extreme, and back it up with facts on both sides. So you should know facts of both sides of any argument. And that's how you should read papers. That's why people say that you should read UPSC preparation material, or you should follow UPSC preparation channels on YouTube, which I'm sure many people do before their interviews. So you can get both sides of the argument. I, in fact, followed one of those channels and I got my points on the CAA, NRC and on the economy from the, some of those videos. And that's how it helped out. About IMC, it was like a dream come true, because I didn't even imagine this season that I would be going, but it was a dream. I wrote a blog on 21st May 2019 that I wanted to go either to FMS or IMC, and on 13th May 2020 the results came out, and it was just fantastic. The first thing I did was call my parents. The first thing I did was shout and interrupt my roommate's meeting at work, for which I had to apologize. But then I called my mom, and then it was a really dream come true, because I'm going home and I've been out of the city for a while. So it was really unimaginable.
Hi guys, Inside IM has come up with an exciting new one-on-one mentorship product where you get to interact with superstar managers from different businesses, different functions. You can ask them everything around your career, your education, your future success. If you are interested, the link is in the description below. Thanks.